the benefit that this bill could have, and that we can restore the confidence in this, the mother of all parliaments.
The question is that the honourable member have leave to bring in the bill. Steve Baker.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Speaker. And in rising to oppose my honourable friend, I do want to begin by absolutely embracing his noble intent and also saying that I'm quite confident that if I were the new member for Totnes or for South Cambridgeshire or any other seat where Conservative voters were absolutely furious about the behaviour of their previous MP, I would be in their position of needing to move this bill or a similar one. I also want to say to him that I agree about the primacy of the voter. My goodness, why did I do all the things that I have done about leaving the EU? I believe in the primacy of voters. And he is absolutely right that I supported Noble Lord Goldsmith's bill. I tweeted out the links earlier. And I'm in favour of full recall. I prefer to avoid total recall. But I'm in favour of full recall, albeit on a threshold that must be high enough to avoid just vexatious political activity. But I would like to have full recall, by which I mean recall without conditions. I even agree with him. Of course I agree with him on the importance of party. He's right, none of us were elected to this Parliament as independents. There are two independents. They both have their own circumstances. But there's an article by me in The Sun setting out in the course of 2019 the crucial importance of people knowing the programme for which they have voted so that they get the government that they wanted. So I agree with him about the importance of party. I'm very clear that we owe a duty to our party in fulfilling our duty to our voters. You know, Carswell and Reckless were absolutely right when they went to their electors, but they went to their electors in circumstances slightly different to the ones that I will come onto. But what I really want to ask the whole House to consider is this. We also have a duty to consider in our deliberations what happens not just when things are going right, or perhaps when things are only going slightly wrong in narrow and foreseeable circumstances. But what if things go terribly wrong in circumstances that we perhaps haven't foreseen? What do we do when things go terribly, terribly wrong? So the problem with my honourable friend's bill is this. It establishes the principle that we are here contingent on our membership of party. Now, I know that he has said that his proposal wouldn't apply if we lost the whip for some other reason. But the problem with that is that in saying so, he has conceded that if we were to be forced to a recall petition and a by-election because we'd lost the whip through our actions, that that would be an unacceptable transfer of power to the party whips and a compromise on our ability to vote as our conscience dictated was best for our constituents and the nation. I'm not going to quote Burke, we all know Burke. I'm going to recommend Auburn Herbert, A Politician in Sight of Haven, a far better essay. But this is the circumstance all of us face. We must balance our own conception of what is best, our constituents and our parties. So that's the problem. And of course, once you've conceded, in conceding that we mustn't allow members to be forced to a by-election because the whips don't like how they voted, I think in a sense he begins to go down the road that I foresee. So what I want to say to the House is this. Imagine a major governing party in the United Kingdom captured by a charismatic and radical leader, buttressed by ruthless and ideological advisers, accomplished in the political arts. Imagine that party with that leader and those advisers hell-bent on dramatic change to our institutions of the British state. Well, of course, as colleagues say, never. It is inconceivable that such a thing should happen in the Conservative Party. But I do want to apologise to members opposite, because I do now need to trespass on matters which are properly for the Labour Party, and in a speech which can take no interventions, I wish to do so lightly. And I'll leave many things unsaid which might strengthen my case, but I'll leave them unsaid to avoid reopening old wounds. Many members will be able to bring to mind the things of which I refer. There are many things which happened last year which ought not to have happened. I count amongst my friends Gavin Shuker, the former member for Luton South from 2010 to 2019. He's given me this quote, which I'll read in full, his words until I indicate otherwise. In effect, this proposal would be a huge shift of power, not to our constituents, but to the respective party leaderships. Imagine the chilling effect on debate, the incentive for a member to be bullied out of their own party. We have to ignore our own history to become advocates of this approach, and not ancient history, recent history. When I chose to sit as an independent, it was on an issue of integrity. Like many of my colleagues, I could not advocate putting a man so universally ill-suited to leadership into 10 Downing Street. Unlike many of them, I chose to embrace the consequences, he says. I knew full well that at the next election I would likely not be returned, and in the end that's exactly what happened. The same people who elected me chose not to return me. The system worked, and all without this bill. MPs in this House are not delegates, he writes, and I'll allow him this. We are representatives. The knowledge that when a party changes beyond all recognition around a member, that member may choose to resign the whip, that is an important safety valve in our system and a good bit of political hygiene. This proposed legislation is rooted in a popular argument which at first seems very clever. It's not very wise. And those are the words of my friend Gavin Shuker, who of course was the convener of the Independent Group. As I said to one of my colleagues, I was going to make this argument as I came in, and he replied, well, yeah, imagine that a Conservative leader became woke and decided that to speak of free enterprise was a hate crime. Well, we'd need a lifeboat. Well, indeed we would. Indeed we would. But what I want to say to the House is this. I'm afraid we do need to consider very serious contingencies. If one wished to replace a party of government with another because it had so unrecognisably changed, perhaps because a segment of society genuinely feared for their lives if it came to power, that's what happened. One would have to smash that party with sustained pressure and velocity, with meticulous plans, detailed knowledge of every member of parliament and when they would leave their party, what they would say and what they would do and with whom. One would really need to know what they were going to do, and they would need time. They'd need, for example, not to be driven to European elections for which they were not ready. I think all the people who left the Labour Party were heroic in what they did. They were seeking to ensure that this country had a fit opposition and an alternative party of government. And it was necessary for them to have the scope and the space and the freedom to still sit in this House and have this platform in the national interest to try and recreate a viable opposition. Now, as it happens, those who chose to stay in the Labour Party and rescue it have won. Well, I congratulate them, because we do need a good opposition. But what I want to say in concluding is that this House surely is about nothing if it is not about restraining power. Of course my honourable friend makes a good argument, and of course if I was in his situation, I might well make the same argument. But what I'd say to colleagues, if really we want the public to be able to recall us, let's really give them the power, without conditions, on a high threshold, high enough to avoid vexatious political activity. Because goodness knows, after all we've been through, we need political stability. My goodness, we have seen this Parliament, this place, this Constitution, not just working at 100%, but perhaps as the rules have been stretched and almost broken, perhaps broken. We've seen our Constitution operating at 110%, and what a dread thing it has been. And as somebody who has been subjected to the full wrath of the state at least 3 times, and members will know which votes I mean, my goodness, I do not want to be that person who leaves their party on principle and then in their constituency faces the might of that state trying to procure signatures on the petition. And that's amongst the reasons. Of course, I've spoken long enough, and what a privilege it is to be able to put this on the record. But it is because of the dread power of the state, the dread power of party gone wrong, that I would say to him and say to his voters, please bear with us. Because what we're saying here is not you can't get rid of your MP. All those defectors lost their seats. They all lost their seats. We're not saying you won't be able to get rid of your MP. We're saying to you, please be patient. Because if we've learned anything over the last year or so, it's that this amazing constitution that we have, this amazing, tarsham, wearisome, awful place that's so brilliant, is capable of protecting our freedoms in this nation. And members of Parliament, for all we're all elected on a party ticket, for all the duties we owe to the public via our party, it remains absolutely essential to the freedom and health of this nation that we are able to walk away from our party and seek to destroy it. Though I can tell my whip I have no plans to do so.
The question is that the Honourable Member have leave to bring in the bill. As many as that opinion say aye.
Aye.
Of the contrary, no.
No!